to the public hearing on the proposed town operating budget and the Board of Education budget. We'd like to first begin with a roll call first of the town council.
Here.
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 And for the Board of Education?
Here.
Here.
Charles Johnson.
Here.
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 Thank you, Suzanne. There was a, I need to read the public notice, Town of Enfield Legal Notice Public Hearing Proposed Budget Fiscal Year 2012-2013, Wednesday, April 25th, 2012. Notice is hereby given that the Town of Enfield shall hold a public hearing on the proposed annual operating and capital budget for the fiscal year July 1st, 2012 to June 30th, 2013. The public hearing shall be Wednesday, April 25th, 2012 at 7 p.m. in the auditorium of Enfield High School, 1264 Enfield Street, Enfield, Connecticut. All electors and taxpayers will be provided an opportunity to express their opinions and further give written and or oral comment regarding the proposed budget. Dated on the 22nd of March 2012, signed by Suzanne F. Olicknicki, our town clerk, and it was published in the Hartford Courant on Friday, April 13th, 2012. The format for this evening's public hearing, first we will have a presentation of the town budget by our town manager, Matt Koppler, followed by a presentation of the Board of Education budget by Chairman Tim Neville. After the two presentations, we will open up the public hearing to the audience. There is a sign-up list at the town clerk's table. Please sign up with Suzanne. During your comments, based on our rules and procedures, your comments are to be kept to no more than 3 minutes per turn. As we exhaust the list of those that have signed up, we can then begin a second round as well. And our rules allow for as many rounds as folks would like to participate. And when you come forward to the microphone, which is to your right or left, please state your name and address for the record. And again, keep your comments to no more than 3 minutes. And we ask that you refrain from the use of personalities. If there are any specific questions that are given during your statement, once we have completed a round, we will then ask appropriate staff or officials to respond to any of the questions that were posed during the public hearing. So I would ask members of the board and of the council to recess to the audience or to the auditorium seating. And we'll first have the presentation by Matt Koppler, followed by Tim Neville.
Thank you, Mayor Copen. Good evening, everybody. Thank you very much for spending a little bit of time with us going over the proposed fiscal year 2013 budget for the town of Enfield. And just for reference point, at the back, we do have complete budget books that reflect the proposed budget, as well as a copy of the presentation that I'm about to embark on right now. The budget process for the town of Enfield begins back in November of last year. And at that point, the department directors were asked to submit to my office by almost the end of January a detailed department expense plan. And at the time, I had requested them to put together a plan that did not have more than a 1% increase overall in their budget. During the month of February, I met then with the different department directors, myself, the director of finance, the assistant town manager, and went over what they were proposing for the upcoming year. It culminated on March 19th with me submitting to the town council the proposed budget that, again, is here we're going to be talking about tonight. April 5th is part of council's desire to have as much input on the budget process as possible. We held a community conversation. During the month of April, we have already started with council having budget hearings with the departments to go over what they're proposing within the budget. And of course, tonight, April 25th, we're having the public hearing, which is mandated by the charter for residents that wish to comment on the proposed budget. After this, council will be getting put together into a room, lock the door, and they're not allowed out until they finally get a budget adopted, which will happen no later than May 18th of this year. So July 1st, a budget's in place. Should always start with what are the things that are going to be impacting the upcoming budget. Obviously, we are a entity that gets quite a bit of money from the state of Connecticut, so what they do with their budget has a dramatic impact on the town of Enfield. Within the governor's budget, and pretty much the same from the finance committee and the legislature, the town is expecting to receive about $525,000 more this year compared to last year. Most of that money, about $430,000 of it, is going directly to the schools for their budget. Another factor affecting the budget, the upcoming budget, is Storm Alfred. And I know this happened at the end of October last year, but it's something that's going to have an impact on the town of Enfield for some time to come, primarily because the cost of cleanup took over $1.45 million from our general fund undesignated fund balance. And this hopefully also represents the total commitment from the town for that cleanup. But there is a possibility if we don't get the funding, the matching funding from the federal government on that cleanup, that this number could get worse. That's then forced us to reduce the amount of money that we generally put towards the next year's budget to $1.6 million. And there's a slide a little bit later on that shows that in previous years, for instance, the current year, we've used as much as $2.8 million to balance the budget from the general fund undesignated balance. This year is one of the years where our debt service costs decreased by $800,000, which is a positive. We're looking at the second half of the year seeing a drop in our municipal solid waste disposal, as well as on the other side on recycling, we're going to see an increase in the rebates that we receive for recycling, going from approximately $5 up to $22.50. On the downside, of course, like every place else, our health insurance costs expected to increase somewhere between 3 to 6%. And unfortunately, our workers' compensation costs is projected to increase by 15%, which equates to about $200,000 in next year's budget. Looking back, the town of Enfield over the last 4 years has embarked upon a cost reduction strategy to try to keep the impact of the provision of the services that we provide to our residents at the lowest possible rate. You know, we've gone through staff reductions, we have wage freezes, we moved from a fully insured health plan to a self-funded health plan, and we made plan changes that in the end have the employees paying more either from a contribution on the premium or for the visits or for the RXs. But we've adjusted those to try to pass the cost back to the employee. We've done a bond refunding, and that saved 2 years ago $500,000 in our overall budget. We've consolidated with the Board of Education, the building maintenance, custodials. And that's, and although I don't have the exact dollar amount on this, we know that from when we took it over to from the schools to today, that we've seen a decrease in the overall operation cost of that division. In some areas, we've reduced services. And in others, we've changed the way that we go about providing those services. As an example, the solid waste pickup, we went from a 5-day work week to a 4-day collection cycle. And in the recycling, we went from a more manual-based system to a tipper automatic system. All these things are working to try to reduce the cost to government. And we've been fairly successful. This is a slide that shows the net cost of services going from 2008 to last year, 2011. And this comes from our audit book, if you want to go look at the specific numbers on this. But what you see here is our cost, net cost of services, has dropped dramatically from 2009 to the end of last year. And we see that continuing as we go forward. And you know, this represents the town's efforts to reduce those costs, squeeze it down as much as possible, but still be able to provide a high level of services to our residents. So getting kind of jumping into where we're going, this graph represents the general fund revenues versus expenditures going back all the way to 2007 to the proposed budget in 2013. What I'd like you to take away, though, from this, besides seeing that there in 2009 we kind of peaked over $118 million in expenditures for both the town and the Board of Education, is to pay attention to the gap between the revenues and the expenditures. That gap is what is filled by the undesignated fund balance. And you can see starting back in 2007, it was a little over $1 million that we were using to balance as part of the budget process to balance the budget. It grew all the way here to 2012 to be $2.8 million. And again, as I said earlier, we're now moving it down to 1.6. And from our professional opinion, you know, we need this number even less, which we would really like it to be, you know, this number equal to that number. So we have a ways to go. Revenue for the town of Enfield is $115,608,244. It's broken down, 68% of that revenue comes from property taxes, vehicle taxes, and personal property taxes. 29% is intergovernmental funds. And those are primarily the money that we're receiving from the state for ECS and other school-related activities, as well as getting a pilot payment in lieu of taxes for state buildings that are in our town to any other types of grants that we may be receiving from the state. 2% of our budget is made up of the user fees, the licenses, that we collect from somebody coming in and, you know, getting a record from us or getting a building fee, a building permit, or what have you. And this year, fund balance makes up only 1% of our budget. From a high level, our general fund expenditures, again, because we have to have a balanced budget, $115,608,244, is broken down between the town budget of $52 million plus and the Board of Education budget of $63 million plus. And going to the next level of detail on this, again, you see the Board of Education budget over here. But from the town side, our largest single entity is Public Works, and we're looking at budgeting $16.5 million for their expenditures. The next largest single operation is our public safety. That's a little over $12 million. General government, which I know is a bigger number than either of these, is really the expenditures for, you know, whether it's council, the town manager's office, finance, probate, register of voters, but it's also all the transfers that go to the different funds that we have, as well as paying for our pensions and those type of employee-related non-assigned costs that we do. Then we have library going at $1.6 million, and development services, which is planning, economic development, building, make up $1.2 million. I want to talk a little bit about those intergovernmental revenues, because that really is one of the driving forces in how our expenditures and revenues kind of go up and down. You can see in 2009, I had mentioned that we had peaked, if you remember the slide, up around almost $119 million in expenditures. And the driving force really was the state revenues that we were receiving. The state at that point in time had increased, as part of their two-year budget, the amount of money that we were receiving. But then as the economy started going south, we also then started seeing the revenues from the state go south. And actually in 2012 is the first year that we saw it kind of bottom out, and they started to add a little bit of revenue to it. And in 2013, we're going to see that number go up again, primarily by that $430,000 or the 525 we talked about, mainly for the Board of Education expenses. We do have other funds that do derive revenue from the general fund. We have the EMS, which of course are emergency medical services. That's going up. The lighter color here is the current year's budget. The darker color is the proposed budget. And over here, this, which I'm told is green, is the general fund contribution. And you can see the EMS cost-wise is going up. WPC, we actually have a slight decrease in that overall expenditure plan, but the primary funding source is general fund tax dollars. Social services, budget's going up a little bit this year again. About a quarter is being funded by the general fund. And then information technology, again, shows an increase due to some of the different services and programs and hardware that's going on there. And again, the general fund of the town of Enfield pays a portion of that. The other big revenue source is actually the Board of Education, and in their budget you'll probably see the amount of money that they're transferring over to make up quite a bit of that as well. Mill rate trend over the last few years. You can see since 2008, we've kept the mill rate and the tax the same, 2388. This year, we are proposing an increase, but it's not as a dramatic increase as what it shows there. Point out here, in between 2007 and 2008 was our last reval, and the amount of grand list had grew actually tremendously, which allowed us to reset this number, the 3618 mill rate. It went down to actually, I believe at the time, was 23.89 per thousand. But in the that year, council had actually decreased the tax rate by 1/100th of a mill, went down to 2388. That's where it stood until this year, or the next year proposal, of going up to 2784. If you were to look, because of the grand list numbers going down, and we had about a 13 to 15% decrease overall in that grand list, the rate that if we collected the same amount of tax dollars in the current year with next year's grand list, I believe this went up to 2694, I believe, 26, somewhere around there. But we are proposing a mill rate increase of the upcoming year, so it's only a 0.9 mill increase. And so that does have an impact on the assessment and the tax burden. And I just put together real quick a slide here that shows the 2012 assessed value versus the 2013 assessed value at that average 15% decrease. You can see in 2012, the current year, if you had a home that was assessed for $100,000, if you were an average, saw the average decrease, you went down to $85,000. And you can see overall, going from a 2388 to the 2784 is actually a reduction still of $22. $150,000 home with an average 15% decrease goes down to 127.5. And with that, the tax burden goes down $32. And I do the same thing here for the 200 and 300. Now, if unfortunately you're one of the homes that didn't go down the average, you know, these numbers are going to be different for you. And if your value actually went up, obviously there's going to be a burden shift to that individual. This year was a little bit different than the last assessment reval as well, as we saw a shifting from the industrial commercial to the residential. So we had people, even though their value may not have went up dramatically, they actually did go up because of that shifting from the commercial properties not going up as high as what the residential properties were. This year is the opposite. What we're seeing is the commercial industrial properties did not go down as dramatically as what the residentials went down. And so that shift of the burden is actually happening the reverse with this go around. And I do want to point out, going back to this real quick, is the fact that where you see this, you know, reduction for both vehicle and personal property, you're not going to see a reduction. We do appraisals on vehicles and personal property every year. And so you will see an increase in the amount of money that you're paying in taxes on vehicles and personal property. And again, where it used to be 2388 going forward, if this budget's adopted as it is, you'd be paying the 2784. So it's going to be an increase in the vehicles as well as the personal property. Just looking where we stand this year in comparison to other towns, we generally, from a service perspective, compare ourselves to East Hartford, Manchester, Windsor, West Hartford. And you can see that at the current mill rate of 2388, we're significantly below. Now, again, for comparison's sake, these other four municipalities do have fire departments that we don't have in our mill rate. I know we collect the taxes for the fire departments, but they are separate and individual departments. But if you were to take, you know, our mill rate of 2388 and take the average of the five districts, I believe that number actually takes us up around $27 per thousand. Again, that's the average, where you may have a high of 29 and a low of about 26. But even with that, we still fall below these four municipalities that offer similar type services that we offer. And just for another point of reference, East Hartford, I believe, has adopted their budget. They have also gone through a reval, and their mill rate, I believe, is almost $42. The towns beneath the Enfield bar here are surrounding towns, and, you know, from our perspective, do not offer the same level and types of services that the town of Enfield offers its residents. And again, you can see, with it being at 2388, we're pretty competitive with those surrounding towns offering more services to the residents. In fact, I believe there's only two towns here that mill rates in the current year are less than what the town of Enfield offers. And again, we offer more service and higher levels of service to our residents than what they offer. I do want to spend a little bit of time talking about the undesignated, unreserved fund balance in the general fund. This is something that is a principle that council's adopted in the actions that they've taken in previous years, and staff, myself and Director of Finance, always talk about. And it's a need to keep a certain amount of unreserved balance within the general fund. What we strive for is 10%. And you can see in these years here, we're well above what the 10% was. This year, or the upcoming year, if we wanted the fund to be at a 10%, it would be up here where this star is. What we're projecting right now is that we're going to end this year with the fund balance, unreserved fund balance, being down here. That's below our, obviously below our 10% objective. And it's something that we're trying to put a strategy together to get that number back up over the next couple of years. The importance of this unreserved fund balance can be seen in last October. You know, the town was able to react to a very, very, very dramatic storm and be able to help the residents clean up where other towns couldn't spend the money because they didn't have the unreserved fund, because they've been spending it over the last few years to try to manage slowdown in the economy. Another big issue is when you go out into the bond market, the different the credit agencies will look as they market what your credit rating is going to be at how much money you're keeping, your financial strength that you have and flexibility you have within your budget. And again, keeping it at 10%, which is what the recommendations of most of the credit rating agencies are, you know, helps keep our rating strong. And the last time we were out for a credit rating was in 2008. And this is Standard & Poor's analysis. We have with them a AA stable outlook. And just to reiterate what they saw in us, the stable outlook reflects our expectations that the town's financial position will remain strong, characterized by healthy general fund reserves, providing revenue flexibility to address rising employee benefit costs and possible softening of revenues due to economic slowdown. 2008, they looked at us and said, you know, based upon your financial policies, you're doing a good job. We're keeping your credit rating the same as what it was before. Besides saying we're doing a good job, when we go out into the marketplace, for instance, we're going to be selling probably in the next couple of years the bonds for the Roads 2010. It's going to be $25 million. We're looking to put a referendum on for the consolidation of the two high schools. In the end, that could end up being $30+ million. To have and to keep the rating that we have right now could mean millions of dollars over a 20-year life of that bond retirement, which means on an annual basis it could easily mean $100,000+ per year that if we don't, you know, be financial stewards of our money, is going to cost us more money and reduce our ability to react and spend money to keep the budgets solid and intact and keeping the level of service as high as possible. And so that's the thought that we look at, and I want to walk away from this presentation, hopefully you take away from this presentation, that, you know, one of our fundamental desires is to keep our reserves strong, be able long-term to provide the level of services. In the short term, we've taken a lot of different means, as I talked about in the past, in terms of cuts and reductions, but now we're looking to have to start increasing some of our revenue streams, namely the taxes, and that's the rationale for the tax increase, to try to keep our position financially as strong as possible. And with that, I guess I'm done. And I'm going to be turning this over now to Mr. Tim Neville.
Good evening. My thanks to the council for the opportunity to present the board's budget to the community this evening. Budgets and taxes are never the most popular discussion topics in any community. However, we are all keenly aware of these discussions, and the decisions that come from them are some of the most important we make during our terms of office. We also know that our budget decisions have the power to determine the direction of the Enfield community. From the board's perspective, I'm proud of the board for keeping their focus on both the economy and the needs of our students in this community in developing our final budget request. We came up with a budget that focuses on needs, not wants. We addressed an incredible $1.3 million hole in our budget by cutting our budget ourselves. We reined in our desires and came up with what we believe is a minimal and responsible budget for our students, for our community, and for these economic times. Move to the next slide, please. With that said, let me begin with the first slide that details our 2012-2013 budget request. Basically, we're asking for $63,690,447, an increase of 1.56% over the current year's budget, and which constitutes an increase of $979,440. Next slide, please. Every budget process begins with some cost and some cost savers. So what I'd like to do is begin with some cost savers. First of all, our recently initiated K-8 reorganization saved approximately $1 million in our educational budget this year and will have a cumulative effect of saving us $1 million every year in operating expenses. The Stowe School rental, by my estimates, and I haven't verified these with Matt, but I believe approximately $275,000 of rental fees come into the town coffers each year that Greg is using the building. There are additional savings as well with renting the building to Greg. Renting versus leaving it vacant or selling the building leaves us no utilities or maintenance costs. More importantly, it also keeps Stowe in use as a school and allows us to continue reducing the amount we still owe the state for previous construction. It all saves the town money, and that's a good thing. Renting keeps Stowe available as a school if needed in the future or for other town needs without additional cost to the town. Pre-planning for the ARRA money ending. I think all of you know that the ARRA money is stimulus funds that came to schools and towns to help deal with the issues of our heavy recession that we had. We knew at some point that they would stop sending the money and that we would have a hole in our budget that needed to be filled. One of our cost savers was both us and the previous board was taking care of that, and that ended up being a significant cost saver in terms of our upcoming budget. And finally on this slide, donations from industries. Several town industries, notably 3M, Lego, and Staples, donated significant amounts to the town and the Board of Ed. These donations range from furniture and supplies to a $125,000 grant for a family resource center that for Kite and the town's social services department. These kinds of donations are invaluable. They save us real budget monies, especially in lean times. We are happy that Enfield has just generous corporate citizens, and we thank them for their generous support. Key points. When we were putting our budget together, we had a number of budget discussions. This is a non-inclusive list of the things that we talked about and considered important as we built our budget. First was to close the ARRA hole. $1.3 million could not be passed on to the community in a budget hike this year, and so our board worked to close our part of it. The previous board did a large chunk as well. Second key point was to maintain class sizes. We felt that we had an implied promise with the citizens with the reorganization pre-K to 8 that one of the goals there was to have lower imbalanced class sizes. And we felt that as part of our budget process, we should strive to keep those class sizes at that same level. Thirdly, continued support for the 9-12 reorganization or consolidation of the high schools. We looked at that and we wanted to see if we could maintain the staff there as we went through this because we knew there would be a lot of tasks involved in getting this done. And our budget process kept that in the limelight so that we can make sure that our efforts were successful. Maintaining and supporting curriculum. State regulations and new requirements have us doing more work on evaluation and staff development, and we're hoping to provide some monies in our budget to maintain that. Some of that money will also have to come from grant money. Next item, address critical district staff and program needs. Up until now, we've been cutting, and what we wanted to do was bring back some things, some programs and some staff that the staff and the administration and the board felt were needed and were critical to the success of the school district. Some that we brought back would save us money, some that we brought back would address issues that we have not been able to address, and increasing state regulations require us to do that. Begin bringing back some previously cut programs. What we're talking about here, sports, and bring back some additional guidance counselors to continue that guidance program. And these staff positions would also help address community needs. And I think keeping in the forefront, we kept minimizing the financial impact of the community. When we put this together, we had all kinds of things on our wish list, from bringing Latin back to all-day kindergarten and so on. And I think as a board, we put those things aside. Even though they were good, they would enhance the community, but we felt that the town just could not afford those at this time, so we tried to stay with needs and not wants. Next slide, please. Board budgets over time. If you look at the 08-09 year through the current year, we've had a 0% budget for all 4 years. Let me just get to my slide here. As you can see, the past 4 years have maintained that zero budget. There's an asterisk next to the 08-09 budget. There was $7.5 million that went out of that budget when the custodians transferred to the town that year. We've had a number of questions from folks of how did we make it with a 0% budget. And I'd like to list a couple of the ways that we were able to accomplish it. First of all was concessions. All bargaining units but the teachers took a voluntary freeze for 1 year. Secondly, we had modest settlements of contract. People sat down at the table with us, looked at the times, and worked with us to come up with modest settlements on those contracts so that we could survive through this tough time. Three, reasonable arbitration awards. We didn't win arbitration, but I think the report that we put out there, dollar amounts, losing my train of thought here, we were able to convince the arbitration panel that our approach was right and that we couldn't afford those arbitration costs at that time. As you realize, in arbitration, nobody really wins, but what we're looking to do was to take care of the town's needs through that, and a positive arbitration award helped us out through those times. Grants. We lived a lot on grants back then. And that got us through, too. But as you'll see later on in the presentation, grants are being cut not just in Enfield, but throughout the country as well. A primary way to deal with it was through reductions. The council received a sheet detailing staff and other reductions done over the past 3 years, and we can make that sheet available to you if anybody wishes it. But suffice to say, numerous programs and over 90 staff were cut over the last 3 years. Finally, through the efficient and prudent fiscal management, we were able to return monies over the years to the council, and the council was gracious enough to make those funds available to the board for things like textbook purchases, computer lease fees, and other needs. And we're pleased that the council worked with us on that, and we hope that they'll continue collaborating with us on things like that. Next slide, please. Per pupil expenditures by Enfield State and DIRG. These are average, the state and the DIRG are the average per pupil expenditures. The DIRG is our economic and demographic reference group. As you can see from the chart, 2006, 2007, all the way up to 2010, 2011, you can see that our averages, our per pupil cost is not rising at the same rate as our DIRG and the state. Currently, we're $737 below the DIRG average. Those are towns that are similar to us, and we're almost $1,900 below the state average. Being this much below the state and the DIRG averages means that other towns are providing more resources to their students and thereby making Enfield students less competitive compared to their peers in other towns. Enfield's per pupil costs have been significantly below average for 4 of the last 5 years. Next slide, please. This is the foundation of our whole budget request, filling the $1.3 million hole in the budget due to the loss of the ERA funds. And I have to compliment the previous board and the councils for having the foresight to see what damage not doing this would do to the education budget and the town budget. So what they did was they planned. And the previous board set aside $454,617 from last year's board budget. And with the council's agreement, they set it aside knowing that this was the year that we were going to lose our funds. The current board took $627,110, roughly 1% of our budget, and we set that aside. We didn't spend money that was already allocated to us because we knew that if we spent it, we'd have to ask for more or have devastating cuts in the budget. And we wanted to prevent what we thought would be a debacle in the 2012-2013 budget. Next. As with any budget, you make some financial assumptions as you walk through it. And the first one I've just explained, filling the error hole as planned. We knew that we had to do that, or the rest of the budget was going to be very, very difficult to do. We assumed that the excess cost, which is estimated at 70% reimbursement, would stay the same as we went through our budget process. We assumed that the state would support 100% of ECS, educational cost sharing funding, which is critical to Enfield's budget. We assume that the MBR, the minimum budget requirement, will remain intact, and it appears to have done so. And finally, we assume that I'm going to say maybe hoped that grant funding would stabilize. It really hasn't. It's gone down, and it's not just gone down for us. It's gone down for the whole state. Next, please. In addition to financial assumptions, we made operational assumptions in devising our budget. We assumed that the fuel costs for buses would remain within budget. If all of you have been putting gas in your car, you know that's now it looks like a bad assumption, but you know, I'm hopeful that the sign I see, it went down five cents in the last week, it'll keep going down and we can maintain the line item that we have in our budget for that. We assumed that K-6 teacher pupil ratio was maintained, and I told you earlier on when we looked at the key points in our budget that was something that we wanted to kind of hold sacred, and we were assuming that we were going to be able to do that within our budget. As mentioned before, we assume that the staff level remain constant during the 9 to 12 transition, and it's critical that it does that, and hopefully we'll be able to do it. And finally, we assume that we would be able to meet the needs of our special needs students with in-house programs versus out-of-district programs. And this is important for two reasons. One, we think we provide a better program and a more responsive program for these needs within their own these students within their own communities. And secondly, it's incredibly expensive for us to take our youngsters out of town, and we lose control, and I think the parents lose some control of the education that they receive. So this was our plan, and you'll see how that plays out as we go through it. Next, please. I don't think anybody would be surprised if I tell you that our enrollment is going down and that we're shrinking as a school system. We've gone from 2007, 2008, and it looks like it's 6351 up there, all the way down to the current year, where it's 5645. People think that people are just moving out of town and that's why our enrollment is going down. There are actually two reasons why. One is the magnet school enrollment, and the other one is kindergarten. And I have an example here for that. Let me just get my kindergarten is at the current kindergarten size is at 383 students. A few years ago, when I was still in the school system, we used to average 450 to 500 kids every year in kindergarten. This past year, we had 383. As a comparison, the 2012 senior class numbers are 455. It doesn't take a lot of math expertise to figure out it's going down, and that's one of the reasons why we have fewer students. There are 72 fewer students between the senior class and the kindergarten class. Next slide, please. Just like the town, we have significant increasing cost impacts on our budget. And as I mentioned, I was hoping that grants would improve, but they appear to be shrinking. Not just the ARA grant, which we knew was going to go away, but it seems like most of our grants are heading down. And we rely heavily on our grants for a lot of staff salaries and so on. So if you looked at our budget, you're going to see that some of the line items and things like paraprofessionals have gone up. And it's not that we've hired more people, it's rather that we've transferred those salaries because of that were in in grant funds, that came out of grant funds, we transferred those things to the regular paraprofessional salary account. So you'll see some ups and downs on a budget that has nothing to do with adds or deletes. It has to do with just shrinking grants that paid for it. Magnet school enrollment, if you could just go to the next slide, please. This highlights the second reason why our enrollments are down overall. And it's because there's been a significant increase in magnet schools. And nothing I'm going to say here says that I'm against magnet schools or anything like that. What I'm pointing out here tonight is that it has a significant impact on the Board of Ed's budget. Most people think when our enrollment goes down, people are just leaving town. And that's happening in some cases, and then we don't have to pay the money for that. But when they go to magnet schools, the money follows them, and that's fine. But one of the problems is right now is that we've gone from 161 students in magnet schools in 2007-2008 up to the current number, which is 322 in the current year. And if you go to the next slide, you'll see how that affects our budget line items. In the first year, I think it's fiscal year 07-08, we spent $485,000 on tuition. And the blue or purple, it's blue in my paper, is the tuition money for the magnet schools. If you go all the way down to fiscal year 2012, it's just shy of $1 million. And if you add in the special ed costs and the transportation cost, you're getting up closer to $1.5 million. And there's nothing wrong with that, but the money does come out of the school system, and it follows them. And we're losing students. I think people get the wrong idea that we should be cutting our budget because we're losing them. We're not. That money follows the youngster. One of the problems that I've highlighted several times at board meetings and is an issue of fairness, that when a youngster goes to the magnet school, if he decides to come back after October 1, the money stays at the magnet school, and we still have to finance that education. I just think we need to do something about that because our costs are still there. Next. Increasing cost impacts. These are the same kinds of things that the town is dealing with, and the costs are approximately the same. We're getting a health insurance increase of 6.35%. That's what it is currently. What it will finally be, I'm not quite sure. I hope it will go down, but I can't guarantee that. But it certainly impacts our budget. Property liability is up 10%, and workers' compensation is up 15%. And my understanding is we've been told that we'll have 15% increases in workers' comp for the next 3 years. Is that right, Chris? Okay. Additional increasing cost impacts are the unfunded mandates. I think everybody in the world knows about unfunded mandates in this country. Keep adding things onto the curriculum or mandates that we have to do, and the money doesn't follow it. Something needs to be done about it, but again, it's something that's out of our control. Transportation. Our transportation costs went up a little bit because of the four-tier system that we had with the pre-K-8 transition that we just initiated last year. Additionally, because of the increase in magnet school students, we had to add another bus onto that run to take those youngsters to school. Go to the next slide, please. Special education, and again, anything I say about special education is budget related. I'm a former special ed teacher. I agree with what we're doing, but it has a cost impact on us. And it's not so much the cost, it's the fact that it's an unpredictable cost. And I think whatever we can do to make it predictable will help us to plan better and help us to allocate our funds better than we have up to this point. You can see that the special education budget is approximately $11.5 million, or 18% of the fixed cost budget. And we have we had 827 students as of March 2012, but that changes almost on a daily basis. We had 28 outplaced students, 17, we call them LAPS, it's a local agency placement. That means we place those youngsters in outside placements. That's something that we do have control of, and we made a determination that the needs were such that they could be better addressed in an outplaced program. It's the 11 SAPs, or SAPs, the state agency placements. This often is from DCF. It could be the courts. Kids could be placed in a residential treatment center or even a penal institution. And it's Not that that's bad, it's the issue that the bill comes back to us for that, it's out of our control. We just have to pay it. We have 32 youngsters who receive special ed services in magnet schools, and basically we get billed for that. That comes back to us as well. And one of the problems with that, and again, there's nothing derogatory about the special ed program, it's the issue that the costs that happen at CREC are significantly higher than what we pay here in town, okay? They pay almost double what we pay for a para or things like that, we're basically the buyer of the service, so we have to just pay the bill. But it's less expensive for us to provide a fine level of education in-house here, and the unpredictability of this just affects our budget, and it can happen on a daily basis. 504 students are on an increase. There are 21 out of district. We have 174 up to now. More and more youngsters with ADHD are being recognized there, and that's fine. We want those services to be given to them. I bring it up only because it has a cost impact, particularly when it's not something that you can, it's not a number you can control when you build your budget. Next. Technology. We have a 20% increase for the following items in technology. We have a refresh of technology equipment that we're hoping to get on the lease for starting in July. Several years back, we went to leasing equipment so that we could have a predictable schedule of replacement, so we'd have computers that would meet our needs and also meet the state needs, which are increasingly happening on the computer. Part of the funds also go to increasing salary and benefits and increasing operational costs. Next. As I told you, that we made few additions in our budget request, a total up to approximately 1.56% increase. And we looked at it as needs, not necessarily as wants. In fact, we were very, very careful with that. If you look at these, we're looking to add a full-time social worker at the high school, and it's based on a need that I think we're all aware of, the suicide ideation issues that we've had all year. And this social worker would be directly related to suicide prevention. And we think, based on our experience, that this is a critical need. And as I said at the beginning, this is a critical staff need. Elementary schools, we always used to have a counselor in each school. In the elementary schools, with the cutbacks, we went to 0.5 counselor in each of the elementary schools, the 7 elementary schools. By adding one full-time guidance counselor, it would allow us to have one guidance counselor in each of the intermediate elementary schools. We'd still have 0.5 in the primary schools. But this is a need that the administration and the staff feel is greatly needed, and it's a bring back of one of the things that we had cut earlier. If you notice, we haven't gone to bring back a large number of teachers or a large number of programs. We looked at it in an incremental way so that that we could ease into this and bring it back as the needs, as the critical needs arose. Special education, the preschool position and the two paraprofessional for the preschool are directly related to an increase in the preschool enrollment. So those need to be brought in there. We couldn't take those youngsters. The 0.5 ETLA program, which is a special ed program, we have a retirement coming up, I believe, at the half year, and that's a program that needs a special skill set and has some special needs. What we're looking to do is to add in a teacher for half a year to help that transition to the new teacher go on. The other thing that's happening is I believe we're going up to 20 students from 10 or 11 students this year, 20 students next year, and that's the reason why we're adding another paraprofessional into the ETLA program. So again, these are not wants, these are needs. The need is there to do it, and we're trying to address it to make the transition for both the parents and the students as smooth as possible. And finally, on the other, and we could have had a long list, laundry list of things in this column, but we decided to add a non-certified data person on the school side, and their job would be a combination of data analysts, setting up collection strategies, setting up data mining for the school data that we have to collect and report on for the state. And it seems to be increasing every single day. They've taken over some of the webmaster responsibilities, as well as conducting professional development for the technology changes that we have. We think this is a critical need, mainly because of the requirements that we're having, but from the state. But secondly, because a lot of the responsibilities that this person would take over were being done by people who retired in the past year or who are retiring this year. And last but not least is middle school sports. I think I can speak for all of my colleagues on the school board. This was the one item that virtually every student and parent, when we were running for election, came up and said they wanted back. They just didn't like to see this cut. They thought it was important. In fact, it wasn't just this. It was also freshman sports and some of the other sports programs. And again, we'd like to bring back others and recommend others, but we looked at doing it on an incremental basis and hopefully be able to bring back the other programs in the following year. To get to that number, we had to come up with some reductions. And the first two up there are the ERA funds. The previous council's chunk with the $454,000 and the previous board's chunk and the current board's chunk, which is the 1%, $627,000. At the time we put this together, we estimated eight teacher retirees. A number of them come in specialties that are tech ed, math, science. Some of those are very, very difficult to fill, and you can't walk in and get it at a base salary. The other thing is that we had three or four, maybe even five department chairs that retired, and that requires extra certification. So we're estimating $240,000 savings in that between the salaries of the people who are retiring and the people who we would hire. But I think given the skill sets of the people we have to bring back, that's a fairly good number as of now. Substitutes are handled in the regular budget, and what we're looking to do is take them out of the regular budget and fund them via some of the grants that we have, so that would save $150,000. We're taking $90,000 out of the current budget to fund some technology, and that will save some money in the future budget. We were able to reduce the degree change account because we have fewer people who in the system who would be getting that, so we felt we could reduce that by $20,000. And then the remainder of the ERA funds, I think there's $48,000 left, that has to be spent, I believe, by September 30th or thereabouts, okay? And we're using that to meet our obligations for summer school that's required this summer, and the last of that money will be gone by probably the beginning of September, if not the end of it. And the last issue on there is the $31,000 reimbursement from Choice for our kindergarten program. Add it all up, and we have $1,316,227 in adjustments. Next. When I looked at this, I thought it was a pretty chart, but you can hardly see it now. Looking at it, And I read an article the other day. It showed a pie graph of a chart done 50 years ago. It wasn't that much different than this one. But frequently we hear from people that, you know, your budget is mostly salaries and benefits. Every education budget in the country is mostly salaries and benefits and has been for the last 50, maybe even 100 years. That's where the money goes, because the best thing we can do for a child in educating them is to have a high-quality teacher in front of them doing that. We're a people business. Textbooks don't come close to having a bright, articulate teacher up there making sure that your kids are learning and assessing how they're learning. You'll notice that we broke out special ed a little differently. We've usually just lumped benefits and regular ed together, but we broke it out because just to give you an idea, it's 18% it's an 18% slice out of this pie, and the red on the right-hand side is the regular ed part of the budget. It leaves very, very little wiggle room in there to deal with technology, which is 3%, and transportation, which is 4%. And other, which is, I can't see it here, it looks like about 2%. Next slide, please. Every budget report that we've had has a CIP component of it, capital improvement projects. And we limited ourselves to three things that we thought were critical. One, it's kind of a heads up to the town council. We'd like to make them aware when we see a problem, and that's the JFK portable classrooms. They were put in, I believe, in 1992, and they generally have less than a 20-year lifespan. they've held up very, very well. But we're at the point now where we need those classrooms, and we need to make a decision on whether we put some money into them or we look at leasing or buying additional classrooms so that we can schedule the kids. It's not something that has to be done right away. It's on here because we see it as something that needs to be looked at, and both the council and Public Works and all the folks have come over there and are working with us on assessing what our options are. The Autism Spectrum Disorder Program is a wonderful program that we have, and it's been growing over the years. We're at a logical point in the growth of that program where the youngsters are age ready to move up to the next level so they can be with their age appropriate peers. And to put that program in, it'd be coming up from one of the elementary schools to the middle school. We need to take two classrooms, and we need to modify those classrooms a bit so it'd be ready for that program. And we put off bringing it in until 2013-14, I believe. I got the right numbers, Chris? Okay. And we need to get it ready this year. So we wanted to get the town's help to do that. And the last one, playground equipment, is something that's near and dear to every parent's heart. If you've gone around to the school systems, the schools and the playgrounds, you've seen that some of them, or at least a few of them, have been roped off. We have some issues of making sure that they are safe and so on, and we've been able to do that. But one of the reasons we put this down was we were looking at a program we had several years ago, maybe 5 or 8 years ago, where we used to have a kind of a schedule where we would look at playgrounds and on a regular basis look at them and reevaluate them and replace and or repair them on a regular schedule. So we're looking for the town to do that, and they've been very, very agreeable to work with us on this. Next. I'm kind of coming to a close with what I began with, which is our proposed budget. $63,690,447. 1.56% equals 0.34 mil equals $979,440. And based on what I looked at through some stuff I got from Dr. Gallagher, which he got from Matt, a mil for fiscal year 2013 is worth $2,807,000. Am I right? Okay, good. Looking at all this, and I think everybody in this room is saying, how does all this stuff affect me as a taxpayer? Again, I went to some documents I got from Dr. Gallagher, who got it from Matt, although it looks like it's been a little revised when I looked at your presentation, Matt. But I looked at a house that in fiscal year 2000 was appraised for $200,000. In fiscal year 2013, with the devaluation we've had, and it is devalued, but it's $170,000 at that point. In fiscal year 2012, they paid $4,776 in taxes. Fiscal year 13, and I was using an estimated number, Matt, and I think I corrected it, but it came out to $4,846. If this is accurate, the net increase for that house would be $70 a year. If you looked at that on a monthly basis, it'd be $5.83. If you looked at it on a weekly basis, it's $1.43, I think, or $45. Just to put it in perspective, that's our asking. That's what the board is asking. We're asking for a $70 increase. If I did it right, it may even be less than that, based on the number that I just took out of Matt's book here. But that's where we're at. I think it puts it in perspective here. Next, please. Let me make a few final comments here. We're all here because we care about the town and want to do the best for it. I think everybody here knows that. Nobody runs for office to get some glory. You're here to do the best you can to get the best for your town. And we love this town. As board members, we realize and respect that our colleagues on the council have a very difficult task ahead of them. We know it's our collective responsibility to provide a budget request that is responsible and responsive to the needs of Enfield's children and its citizens. As a board, we feel we made an honest effort to do that with our 1.56 request and our cut of the budget ourselves. I ask that you keep the following in mind as you deliberate on our budget allocation. Just some things to consider as you kind of go through this. Let me just find my right page here. it's kind of like a state of the schools, these items. And I think I tried to be as factual as I could with them. So you get a perspective of the things that we were dealing with when we were putting our budget together. So some things to consider as you put together our allocation. With a $1.3 million budget hole, we responsibly cut our own 2011-2012 budget to minimize the destruction that the error hole would have caused the district and the town. We've had 4 years of 0% budget, which means 4 years of decreased budgets. As hard as I've looked, I can find no other district in the state of Connecticut with the same stats. Enfield's per pupil costs have been significantly lower than the average of communities in our DIRG in four of the past 5 years. Enfield's per pupil costs are significantly lower than the state average for five out of the last 5 years, and at this point, we are more than $1,900 below the state average. Over the past 3 years, we've cut over 90 staff members in a number of programs. Two schools have been closed in the past year to increase educational opportunities as well as to save money. This has saved us at least $1 million this year and hopefully $1 million annually from here on in. Looking forward to the high school reorganization, we could save almost $2 million annually in operating costs, as well as increased educational opportunities for our students. Our budget request is lower than the vast majority of Connecticut communities, all of whom have not had 4 years of 0% budgets. There comes a time when you can't do more with less, and we've tried, our teachers have tried. You can only do less with less, and we're having a hard time with that. The cumulative effect of 4 years of cuts and 0% budget decreases your ability to maintain a quality system without more resources. We need to make sure that our students have the resources to compete on a level playing field with students from other towns. We need to make sure our graduates are prepared and can gain acceptance to quality secondary education. We need to get our education system to a point where people want to stay in the town and new people want to move in because of what we have to offer. We want industries to come in because they know that it's desirable as well. Our request increases our total budget by 1.56% over the last years and raises taxes by approximately 1/3 of a mil. You've seen the average numbers for a $2,000 house. It's an increase of around $70 per year. After 4 years, can't we afford this minimum increase? I think we can. I think we need to, and I hope all of you will look at this presentation and the spirit in which it's brought in. We want to improve our town. We want to work with you to do that, and we think we can. So please give it due consideration as you go through your deliberations. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt, and thank you, Tim, for your presentations. We'll now enter the public hearing portion of our public hearing. To remind the folks in the audience that there is a sign-up list at the town clerk's table, which is to the right side, and Suzanne's holding up a sign. We ask that you please sign up. Again, the ground rules are to first, sign up with the town clerk. Second, come forward to the podium and microphone at the end of the right aisle. Please state your name and address for the record. Keep your comments to no more than 3 minutes. We will have multiple rounds if that's so desired. And we ask that you please refrain from the use of personalities. I've got 15 people signed up on this list, and I will mention the person that is up and then the person that is on deck. We just asked the person that is on deck to begin making their way to the podium microphone area so that we can expedite the process. So first up is Kenneth Helinski, followed by Gina Sullivan.
Good evening, Ken Helinski, 11 Beverly Street. As a former Board of Education member and Town Council member, tonight I would like to urge the Town Council to support the Board of Education proposed budget. It's a very minimal amount, 1.56%. Over the past 4 years, as Mr. Neville just mentioned, the budget increases have been zero. And that has had a devastating effect, I think, on our school system. We've lost 116 personnel, 93.4 FTEs, plus 23 aides and tutors. If you look at the decrease in students over that time, it was about 700 students less over the five-year period, and that's about 6 students per teacher laid off. So it doesn't seem like a right ratio. So we know that we really were cutting very, very deep into the school system. I think the additions that the board has proposed are reasonable. They're looking to add 7.5 FTEs to the school system and in strategic primary areas. Special education area, the elementary school guidance, social workers at the high school, and data collection analysis, and last but not least, the middle school supports. Not only that, our per pupil expenditure data is low compared to all of the state and region numbers, as Mr. Neville pointed out. I think for all of those particular reasons, I think it's reasonable now with the economy starting to turn around that we add a little bit back into our school system and start to reinvest into our educational process. I think it's a reasonable request, and I would like to urge the Town Council to please support it tonight. Thank you.
Thank you, Ken. Next up is Gina Sullivan, and actually Gina has a submitted write-up, which I will read. On deck is Sue Braun, and just so everyone knows, this is Gina Sullivan, and she's singing in front of Fenway Park. You can hold it up. I think she didn't think that we'd actually hold up her sign, but Gina Sullivan, 11 Spear Avenue. I would support the BOE proposed budget. If I saw more money going to the schools and programs that the children desperately need. When I see the majority of it going to teacher and administration salaries, as well as benefits, it makes me question who we are more concerned about. I want the best for the children. I do realize that our children would have nothing if we didn't have the wonderful teachers that Enfield schools have, but I think everyone needs to share a bit of the burden. A total compensation package includes salaries as well as benefits, and it is my understanding that the benefits are top-notch. These are very hard times for everyone. If a salary increase was not given for 1 year, but the benefits remained top-notch, that seems to be a very fair trade-off, since many of us non-union employees have not seen any increases for quite a few years. In addition, our benefit costs continue to rise, and that our increase hits our pockets. If we want to help our children have an opportunity for a better education, we all need to give a little, meaning taxpayers, teachers, and the administration. If we all work together, we will be giving our children nothing but the best, which is what they deserve. Thank you. Again, signed Gina Sullivan, 11 Spear Avenue. Now you can't draw on it, Ken. Next up is Sue Braun, followed by Jack Sheridan.
Sue Braun, 17 Light Street. I had a whole bunch of stuff that's copying what everybody else just said, but I'm going to say it. The budget for the Board of Education has not been raised in 4 years. A 0% increase, I believe it means a 4.5% decrease. Yet every year the costs go up. As Town Council argued at the last meeting that I went to, the costs rise because 75% of our BOE budget is spent on personnel. I would argue that it shouldn't be spent on anything but personnel. A library does not open without personnel to open it. We experienced this at the beginning of the elementary school year when my son actually did not go to library until the end of October because there was nobody there to open the library. My other son went once. And then October, we got library aides. Without a classroom teachers, kids get nothing out of their day except a great bus ride. Without the principal's discipline, meetings, communication with parents, these things wouldn't happen. Special education, without the teachers, we wouldn't have it. We would have incredible incurring lawsuits, though, that would bury this town. Without guidance counselors, we run the risk of elementary kids not having the mental and emotional help that they really need. At the middle and high school level, without guidance counselors, we lack mental, emotional help, as well as picking out course selections and the possibility of college help. The discussion then led town council to saying that teachers' union did not give any concessions. Neither did the police union. The contract was negotiated last summer. It went into state arbitration, as Mr. Neville mentioned, and then it was finalized. A 0% increase makes cuts that we can no longer afford. The guidance counselor at the 3-5 level would not be hired. Sports at the middle school would not be added. The new data collection professional development position would not be added. At the high school level, Dr. Gallagher has recommended cutting the career paras, reducing a full-time teacher for math, English, gym, social studies, the librarian, and an assistant principal. The middle school level, one math intervention teacher and one reading intervention teacher. Two elementary math teachers, a first grade teacher at Hale and Enfield Street, and a half-day kindergarten teacher at Hale would be reduced. A reduction in district supplies of $35,000. And, oh, those library aides are gone. Now, on a personal level, I have three children in the school system. Kindergarten, third grade, and eighth grade. I have budget cut suggestions for the school system. Judging on the number of people here, I should have made them at the last meeting. I suggest we cut band and sports. They're not tested. We could also get rid of the lunch aides. Just put them in the lunchroom alone. The kindergarten, they don't need specials anymore. It's only a half-day program, although I believe it's mandated to be a full-day program in 2 years, unless somebody puts that off. If we get rid of the specials, maybe we could use those special teachers in the lunchroom to cover for the lunch duties. At the middle school, get rid of the library. They don't read. It saves money. Let's hope it helps. To continue, I would suggest that perhaps we look at the studies that indicate that an educated, well-cared-for child is less likely to commit a crime, more likely to buy a house, more likely to make enough money to help society, more likely to volunteer in some capacity. I do not want to raise other people's children, but I do want things in place so that my child can sit in a classroom, and if another child is being disruptive, they actually get the help, and then my child can go on and learn. The cuts will prevent this from happening. I would also like to see the alternative high school back in place for the same reason as my son heads to high school next year. I think each and every one of you who vote for a 0% increase should then sign up to be a substitute in the schools. The no frills, oh, I'm a town council member, I'm going to waltz through the schools, but an actual substitute. For example, kindergartners must read by the end of kindergarten. They must be able to write a sentence and spell their muscle words correctly. Just 7 years ago, it was words and emergent reading that was required. Before that, it was socialization mixed with recess and snack. The retention in first grade is huge because we cannot get these kids out of the grade on level. They should they should be on. The parents recognize that keeping them back in kindergarten, it doesn't do any good. It's only a 2-hour and 25-minute program. If we could offer a full day kindergarten, we would accomplish the goal set forth by the federal government, the state government, and this town. But we can no longer do this. Anyhow, thank you.
Thank you, Sue. Next up is Jack Sheridan, followed by Tom Serrard.
Jack Sheridan, 7 Buchanan Road. I had a few questions. One was the fact that the school's Board of Ed hadn't had a raise. When you look at the federal grants and the AARA money, there were raises. There were increases beyond what was stated. And if you take the Board of Ed budget as it stands now and then add the federal grant money, state grants, local grants, the $7.5 million that it takes to maintain the school buildings themselves and the other grant money for school resource officers and all that, it comes out to a total of $77,546,687. Divided by the students, that comes out to over $14,000 per student. So, to me, if you want to talk about the real money, with the actual money that it costs for a student, you have to add all of those things in, as I've been talking about in the past. And when you look at the budget and you look at the fact that I'm leaning away from the microphone so I can see the $454,000 and the $627,000. Those were actually monies that should have been added in because they were monies that weren't spent. And so it seems to me that they could have been applied better to a bottom line savings as opposed to just looking for other places to spend that money. and if I look at the capacities on the schools, I see that the total capacity versus the enrollment, there's 874 seats below capacity right now in student count. And if you look at the high schools, that comes to 358 under capacity. So currently, we have the capacity for a lot more students than are attending the schools. So I think there are ways that the budget can be honed down. I had a few other notes here. The compliance issues with the schools as they stand now, if the compliance issues aren't funded, then we ought to be looking at that and complaining about the fact that if there's issues with the compliance of these schools, then we ought to be looking for some kind of funding for that. And I think that on the town side, EMS has to be looked at and social services has to be looked at. I think there's ways that we can save some money on that side too. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jack. Next up is Tom Serrard, followed by Sandy Donnellan.
I'm Serrard, 32 Denuncio Avenue. You'll have to excuse me, it's been a long day. I have to use my device in order to read you my comments. You can hear me? For many reasons, since the end of my tenure on the Board of Education, I have stayed away from public hearings with regards to anything that has to do with Board of Education or Enfield Public Schools. Most of that is respect. I would have continued to do that if not for the intentional misinformation being spread by some of our more prominent citizens for political reasons and political reasons alone. In short, they are playing politics with our kids. And as a parent, I find that repugnant. Ethics prevents me from suggesting to you how you should vote with regards to the proposed budget, but doesn't prevent me from correcting the record and some of the misinformation that has been floating around town. I have every faith that if you base your judgments on educated and informed, correct information, that you will make a good judgment and you will continue to have the support of the public in general. Enfield has a good school system. To imply otherwise, regardless of your motivation, is to impugn the character of our teachers, our administrators, and our staff. When you compare school districts, you have to be careful to compare apples to apples. We don't live on the I-95 corridor or the Gold Coast. We don't live near a thriving industrial center. We don't receive the same level of state aid as Hartford, New Britain, or New Haven. We don't have brand new buildings. We don't have buildings incorporated into our school budget. We don't have the same wherewithal as Fairfield County. We are Enfield. We are unique in many respects. Again, I say it, we have a very good school system. From 2007 to 2011, we improved our school system rather than accepting the status quo. Enfield was innovative in its approach. We incorporated the community in many aspects of the renovations that we've done to our school system and how we deliver education. We instituted changes that will be and are now a model for the rest of the state. From 2009 to 2011, the Board of Education invested more in the nuts and bolts in education than any five previous incarnations of the Board of Education. Textbooks, technology, and tools for teachers. As was reported by Mr. Duffy earlier this year, we have college placement rates on par with some of the best schools in Connecticut, including Fairfield County, regardless of the fact that we don't have the same kind of income. As far as standardized tests are concerned, Enfield, Connecticut ranks in the middle, but it is only a few tenths of a point away from the top third. Connecticut, it should be noted, has some of the toughest standardized tests in the country. So it is an easy leap to say that we have a very good school as school system is concerned with the national level. Since we do have the toughest tests, our students perform better than they do on a national level. It is important to remember that what hurts school budgets, as Mr. Neville has implicated, and every other Board of Education and every other candidate that has ever run for Board of Ed, is unfunded state mandates. That's what hurts our budgets. And what ends up happening is the towns end up turning back to the citizens here in town and in other towns through increases in property taxes to pay for the state's shortfalls. It bothers me when people, even with good intentions, impugn the Enfield school system. It is also important to remember that the changes that were instituted were bipartisan. They were almost unanimous every time in votes. And for one group to point to another and say they have somehow devastated the Enfield school system is intellectually dishonest.
Thank you, Tom. Next up is Sandy Donnellan, followed by John Fox.
Okay, can you hear me? Yep. Sandy Donnellan, 12 Circle Drive. I'm here to support the 1.56% increase in the education budget, which has been proposed by the Board of Education. I feel this increase is reasonable and vitally needed in order to maintain current services. The past few years of 0% increases have led to unfortunate cuts in programs and staffing. If we wish to be known as a town that truly cares about our children and truly cares about the quality of life for all Enfield residents, then we need to strongly support our school system. A dynamic, top-notch school system benefits everyone by creating a caring, educated, and vibrant community. Let's work together to nourish our schools with positive support, enthusiastic commitment, and adequate funding. I urge the Town Council to grant the Board of Education's proposed budget and even surprise them by rounding it up to 2% to show a generous learning spirit.
Thank you, Sandy. Next up is John Fox, followed by Carol Sensky.
Very good meeting so far, and I have to say I'm really surprised that we're having this discussion over 1.56% increase in the Board of Ed budget. It's amazing to me that the statistic of $5 a month is basically what we're talking about in increased taxes. If I understood him correctly, we're talking about $5 a month, $70 a year to offer a little more. And I'm talking a very small amount more for our education system. You know, we're at a crossroads here as a town. We're competing with other towns in this state and other states for people to move here because of our education system. And, you know, that's not the only thing that concerns me about our lack of investment over the last 4 years in education in Enfield. I disagree with, you know, the previous speaker. 360 people have decided to send their children to magnet schools. I mean, does that make any sense? So the quality of life for those kids has to be greatly diminished just by the simple fact that they have to travel so many hours every day to go to magnet schools. And we as a town really have to look at ourselves in the mirror and acknowledge that we've failed these kids. There's no reason we can't offer them something right here by spending maybe $10 more a month. And I believe money is a symbiotic relationship with improved education. We offered a lot more for, you know, basically the same percentage 25 years ago. I would have never seen, I think, even 10 people out of my class go to a VOAG school. But now it's just a normal circumstance that these people have that as an option. That's not right. And these kids getting out of our schools no longer have the type of industry that we had growing up. Even the industry of insurance industry or Hamilton Standard or Pratt & Whitney, they don't have these options. We need to provide the best education we can so that maybe these kids can stay in our town, not have to rent an apartment or stay at their parents' house for, you know, 30 years or whatever just because we didn't prepare them. And it's up to us to pay the $5. I don't have any kids in the school. I don't have any kids. But I would pay $10, $15, whatever, as an investment into this town. And I don't see any reason why, you know, we can't do that, you know, as well as politicians, as citizens. And hopefully we'll recognize other investments and improve this town, improve what we have to offer, compete with everybody else, and draw in these people who, you know, have the higher incomes, who can support our local economy. That's what I'm talking about. There is an interdependent relationship between a good education system and local business. If you bring in people who can't afford to live anywhere else because, you know, the school system is what it is, you know, they're not going to have the kind of money, you know, to support our town. I hope I've made my point clear. It's embarrassing to me that we're sitting here quibbling over 1.56% increase after 0% for 4 years. I mean, that is, it just doesn't get any worse than that. And I hope you guys do the right thing. Thanks.
Thank you, John. Next up is Carol Sensky, followed by Jill Kravitz.
I live at 16 Hoover Lane. As a taxpayer, I fully support the Enfield Board of Education request for a 1.56 increase in town funding for the 2012-13 fiscal year. I recognize that everybody has a different idea of what is needed for this town. However, I do believe there are some things we all agree on. We all know and understand that there is a direct correlation to a great school system and a great town to live in. Whether or not you have children in the school system, we know that better student performance, programs, and services attract new residents. By making Enfield a more desirable community to live in, our property values will go up. The more people that are attracted to this town will also help attract more businesses, keep established businesses from shuttering their windows. By attracting more businesses, we increase our commercial tax base, which in turn will increase our grand list and ease the tax burden on residents. It is a fiscal cycle in a positive direction. There's also no denying that the world has become more competitive than ever. With unemployment nearer in double digits often, it is difficult for people to find good paying jobs. The children today need to have a solid education behind them, more than just the bare bones system we have been offering. Colleges look at the school you come from, not just your GPA or SAT score, but the types of classes offered and electives they take. By continuing to understand the educational system in Enfield, by continuing to underfund the educational system in Enfield, we are not giving these students here a chance to at a great college in the future job market. We cannot let our children become victims of a political stalemate, whether Republican or Democrat. We need to set some of our differences aside and put the people, including the children, first, not our political careers. I understand that times are tough right now. After more than 4 years of a 0% budget increases, despite rising inflation, the school system has had to learn to live on less, just as taxpayers have had to do. The effect on our educational system from 4 years of a 0% budget increase is substantial. There are as follows: 93.4 full-time certified and non-certified staff, 23 part-time workers, elementary summer school, elementary intramurals, JFK sports, freshman basketball and football, implemented pay to play. These are all the things we've lost over the last few years. So not only have we cut staff back, we have cut the summer school program, which helped many early learners with reading and math difficulties. A friend's daughter was fortunate enough to attend the last year of summer school offered. Because of that program, she is now a much more successful student. I wonder how many other students have missed out on an opportunity to benefit from such a program. At a time when obesity is a growing epidemic, we have cut elementary and middle school sports programs and freshman basketball and football programs. Instead of encouraging children to be more physical, we are sending them the message that physical activity is not important once the PE class ends. As a taxpayer, I believe the Board of Education has presented the Town Council with a fair budget. What they are asking for is not excessive. Some of the most needed expenditures include a social worker and an elementary counselor. It is sad to note the rash of suicides among our youngest adults and children. By adding in the requested social worker and counselor, we are putting professionals in the children's path before they feel there is no hope left. As was said by members of the PLA to the Town Council 4 years ago, funding education in Enfield is crucial to the future health of our community. In that regard, as a taxpayer, I fully support the Enfield Board of Education's request for a 1.56% increase in town funding for the 2012-13 fiscal year, and ask that you do as well. And just for the record, I have no children in the system, and I have no grandchildren coming up in the system, but I do believe that having well-educated students and a good program in this city makes us a more viable city. Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. Next up is Jill Kravitz, followed by Kathy Thompson.
Thank you, Mayor, for pronouncing my name correctly. I appreciate that. Jill Kravitz, 124 Town Farm Road. I did not formally prepare anything in writing, so I want to apologize ahead of time. Sometimes I do real well with that or not. So I'd like to say that I fully support the request of the Board of Education for their 1.56 20% increase. I went line by line through the budget yesterday, actually printed it before I saw this, and the difference between what the town is offering or proposing and what the board wants is $549,000. I only caught part of the meeting on April 16th of the board, of the town council, because I was away on vacation, and they were discussing what $1 million meant. And we were discussing it in regards to an insurance policy, and $1 million today meant nothing, and that they really needed a $5 million policy to insure the Enfield daycare, because $1 million today means not the same as it used to. So I know that that's a premium you would pay on insurance. It's not real money. It's not $1 million compared to $5 million. But being that said, $549,000 is, it's not that much in the big scheme of things. The slide that Mr. Neville had was incredible. I've looked at that kind of number before. $5.83 a month per family is a small price to pay. I really liked what Mr. Fox and Ms. Sensky had said. They don't have children, but they'd be willing to pay for that. To have quality education would benefit the entire town now and in the future. It would bring, you know, more people to the town, thus increasing our revenue. So I fully support that. I am one of the people that definitely would like the sports. I know that does seem like a want and not a need, but in today's higher education, when they're looking at students, they're not only looking at grades, they're looking at different, you know, volunteer service. They're looking at their sports. They're also looking at their grades. So we would be at a disadvantage for our children if they didn't compete at the level as the other schools were. So I fully support the request of the Board of Education. Since it is a budget hearing as well, I have a question. I just wanted a clarification. As I said, Crazy Me went line by line through the budget, and I could stay here forever, but I won't. I'll only bring out one point of clarification that I would like. I went to the Recreation Department's budget, and the Recreation Department, I would like clarification, is, you know, the swim team, the basketball, the, you know, toddler tots, and those things. We get the pamphlets with all the wonderful services that they provide and the field trips that they provide. Each of those things are all there. There's a fee to do it. So I am looking at the budget, and there's uniforms, there's field trip costs, there's all these things. And I sat there and I said, okay, but we paid for these things. So I'm like, finally, oh, it dawned on me. It must be in the revenue. So I went through the revenue line by line, and I don't see where the revenue is from all the fees that people pay for those sports at the Recreation Department. So if there's a budget for the Recreation Department, I'd like to see which, if you could enlighten me as to where that is in the budget revenue portion. And that's it. If I know that later on, maybe you can answer that question for me. Okay, thank you.
Okay, and Jill, since it's a quick answer, if you grabbed a copy of the budget, turn to page 171, and that's the revenue page for recreation. And then if you have questions, you can come up on round two.
So the revenue section is not in the front with the rest of the revenue?
It's because recreation is its own fund, okay. So the revenue is at the front of the fund.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thanks, Jill. Kathy Thompson's next, followed by Jeff Myjack.
Kathy Thompson, 24 Duff Drive. I'm a homeowner and a taxpayer. I have a few things I'd like to talk to you tonight about the budget. I want to start by mentioning the community conversation you had on the school budget a couple of weeks ago on April 5th. First, you should know that I work as a parish secretary at a Catholic parish. So as a good practicing Catholic, I was very disappointed that the community conversation the town council held several weeks ago on April 5th was held on Holy Thursday. Recall that the Thursday, Friday, and Saturday before Easter, the Triduum, are the three of the holiest and most important days on the Christian calendar. I can't understand why you would schedule a public meeting on the budget on Holy Thursday. You need to be more sensitive when you are set your meeting dates. I understand that only three people showed up, frankly, I'm not surprised. Not only are we having a budget hearing tonight, the Junior Women's Club is holding its annual townwide spelling bee at JFK. Parking lot was packed when we drove by it tonight. You've got about 150 parents attending the spelling bee at JFK Middle School. I know several people who wanted to speak tonight, but they can't because of this conflict. It's unfortunate that parents have to choose. We need to do a better job of scheduling workshops, community conversations, budgets, meetings, etc. So just to help you out, I get an extra calendar from my parish that shows all the religious holidays this year. I've also made a note on my iPad to give you the 2013 calendar when they get delivered. I want to express my support for the 1.56% increase being requested for education. Even though my son and daughter are in college now, I am concerned about the fact that the schools have not seen an increase in their budget for the past four consecutive years. And what this is a failure to invest in education has done to our school system and our community. As was mentioned by Mr. Neville, the increase to the Board of Education's budget is about $5.83 a month, or put another way, a cup of coffee for a week, per week. I'm not a coffee drinker, but I think that might add up. I have a good friend who decided to move her family out of Enfield last summer because of all the cuts being made to our schools. She and her husband were active members of our PTO and did a lot of volunteer work for the schools. But this past year, they just got disgusted with another 0% increase for education. So they put their house up for sale and moved out. And they didn't make any secret about why they were moving out of Enfield. I know other families that have pulled their kids out of public schools because of all the negative changes being forced on the schools. We can't just go about cutting everything. If people get the idea that Enfield doesn't value education, it's going to have a negative impact on our property values. We need to start investing again in education and our children's future. I again support the sports at JFK as well. I'd like to end on a positive note. Thank you for the crossing guards at JFK. They are at their posts every day doing an outstanding job. And I really like the biweekly recycling schedule. And I'm going to give this to Joyce, and maybe she can pass it down. Thank you.
Thank you, Kathy. Next up is Jeff Myjack, followed by Jeff Gentes.
Good evening, Council. Jeff Myjack, 3 Sharp Street. First, I'd like to commend you. I've looked over the budget pretty well, and you guys have done a good job at controlling costs. The one area I am concerned with, though, is our balance, our reserve balance. Back in 2008, when we had our last review by Moody's, we had over $14 million in that reserve. We're now down to $9.2 million. And we're looking to take another $1.6 million out of that in this coming year to balance our budget. I ask you to take a look at that, because if Moody's comes in and rates us again, they are going to downrate us. We don't have the financial wherewithal to go through another disaster if we go through another Storm Alfred or something even worse. So we need to keep that money where it's at, because if our bond rating goes down, we're going to pay for it for the next 20 years. Between the high school bonds that we have to take out and the roads bonds that we have to take out. So please, let's see if we can find a way to get that money back in there. Even if it means we've got to raise our mill rate, I think it's a 0.57 mill rate we'd have to raise it, which is going to cost everybody about another $60 a year. But spend $60 now, save hundreds of thousands every year for the next 20 years is an investment I feel is well worth it. And I too support the increase for the education budget, even though I have no kids in school, I'll have no grandkids in school, but I believe in a better education, and I would support that 1.56 increase. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. Next up is Jeff Gentes. On deck is Nicholas D'Amato.
Hi, Jeff Gentes, 37 Cottage Road. I'm speaking from the perspective tonight of somebody who's relatively new to town. My wife and I moved to town 2.5 years ago. I'm really here to share really a mix of bad news and good news regarding what people say about Enfield, both within town and outside of town. We have a 5-month-old, but even before my wife was pregnant, people would unsolicited say to me within town, discourage us from sending our kids to school here when they're school age. And it's just a fact. And it's in an, people from all different walks of life, people that I see at church, people I see out in the neighborhood, people say these things. And when they just volunteer this information to you, and you should know that that's probably wasn't that way 10, 15 years ago, but that's the point where we're at now. The good news is people outside the town don't know. I haven't ever heard that. People know about the graduation at church debacle, but they don't know about the issues that have been happening with the school and with the school system generally. And we're at a point where it's taken relatively short time to get to the point where people are volunteering these things to newcomers to town. But I think we can reverse this in a few years. And we have to stop starving the school system. This increase, $70 a month, heck, we'll make that up in a property value, if not the first year, soon after that. And we can think about that if people complain to you about raising their taxes by 70 bucks. They'll get that and then some when it's time to move on and time to sell. I have met people my age, people in a similar circumstance, people whose wives are pregnant, have young children in this town. We like this town. And we want, when we're talking to people from other towns, people who are not just considering towns in our DIRD, which is the Wyndhams of the world, but also Somers, also Suffolk. We want to be, we tell people we like living in this town, we want to sell this town, but we need something to sell. And the school system is always going to be number one on what to sell. So really ask that you not starve the school system. This increase is very minimal. Ask you to support that. And then just I want to second Kathy Thompson's comments about Holy Thursday. I imagine it was an oversight and not a deliberate slight of Catholics, but nevertheless, it's a good thing to keep in mind as the governor. Thanks.
Thank you, Jeff. Welcome to Enfield. Nicholas D'Amato, followed by Mary Ann Turner.
Hi, good evening. My name is Nicholas D'Amato. I wanted to take a moment to thank the Board of Education for championing this cause. It's not easy. Seems like a Herculean task. Appreciate it. Thank you very much. I do have a 4.5-year-old who may be entering the school system at some point. We actually moved back to Enfield about three and a half, four years ago. Love it here. Some of the things I wanted to just touch base on. I'm an LPN. I've been a caregiver for the last 12 years. Recently turned into sales, so I'm learning more about the sales end of things. Gojo would love to be added to that list of corporate sponsors that are helping this town. I have emailed several of the board members here and some other people as well, possibly, that might have got that information, but they're running a K-12 extra credit program, which is if you buy 10 cases of soap, you get a free case of Purell or some other different Purell products as well, which, number one, can help reduce absenteeism about 51%. Also, can help with presenteeism, which are kids that are sick that are actually going to school and spreading that sickness to other kids. If you have a good hand hygiene program, that will help keep the kids healthier and more attentive in their classroom. So that is something, some information I have for you guys for that. Also, magnet schools are great. My brother went to a magnet school in high school back in 89. If we're sending 324 students out of town each year to a different magnet school, why don't we have our own when we have schools that are closed here? And we have, you know, people that here that could help fix up those schools. We can employ local people. I also wanted to address the point that I love the fact that there's counselors helping with kids that are facing mental health issues, stuff like suicides. I have a 13-year-old niece who was friends with one of the youngsters that took their lives. And that usually is stemmed from bullying or something else, some other bigger issue that's under the surface. So I really think having those services, it's not even a question if we should have them, we should have more of them. Any way I can help the school system be healthier, operate more effectively, utilize their budget dollars better, I would love to help advocate with Gojo for that, and we also have some other janitorial sanitation stuff as well, and I have submitted some of those emails to you guys. So thank you once again for your hard work. I really appreciate it. Put love in your heart every day and go to work with the positive influence on these children at the core of what you do. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Nicholas.
Pleasure.
Next up is Mary Ann Turner, followed by Bill Thompson.
Mary Ann Turner, Seven Meadow Road. I do want to remind the public that Maureen Brennan had a great idea a few years back, and they put it on the tax bill that you could send extra money to the town, any amount you wanted. So I suggest that they do it. And they can get their name in the paper, like we all did who sent money. Our leaders must remember that education doesn't begin with some isolated bureaucrat. It doesn't begin with a state or a local officials like yourself. Education begins in the home. All great change in America begins at the dinner table. Ronald Reagan. Everyone seems to want to quote him. This evening you've heard a lot. Some said raise my taxes. Some said don't raise my taxes. And give me more, but don't change my taxes. I just want to share how the latter, give me more but don't raise my taxes, actually happened at Enfield in the last few years because of good leadership and bipartisan activities. Over the last 6 years for both town and school board, we've expanded a lot of things in this town with bipartisan support. We supported capital improvements for the Enfield Public Schools and set aside $1 million for facility improvements, new textbooks, new computers, and educational equipment. Thank you. We upgraded the information technology capabilities by investing significantly in updates to our hardware and software system and infrastructure. Thank you. Consolidated the delivery of services for those of the Board of Education, increasing efficiencies within the IT department, grounds maintenance, and building maintenance by moving them to the town side. Thank you. That was very good work. We executed a new single-stream recycling plan that includes a free 96-gallon tipper barrel, and every household got one, and I love mine, and I thank you. We completed and paid for capital projects, 14 miles of roads, reconstructed or repaved, 10 miles of sidewalk, drainage culverts and channels repaired or replaced on a multiple of roads, and we repaired the South Maple Street Bridge with our other pocket. Federal dollars, and I thank you. Reinforced our strong commitment to public safety with the addition of 3 new officers and a canine officer, bulletproof vests, new weapons, expansion and participation in regional task force and training, and I thank you for that. And we made a priority addressing the economic and commercial development of abandoned properties, business retention, attracted growth, streamlining permitting processes, implementing of neighborhood revitalization, and you all did that. We negotiated new contracts with all the labor groups, keeping the salaries and benefits reasonable. We updated the Enfield school curriculum with updated textbooks with, what was it, $500,000 or $800,000. Thank you. I appreciate it. We improved the Enfield's overall educational standings with higher test scores. We balanced the classrooms from K to 6 and consolidated, and we pre-K to 2 and 3 to 5, and you all know that, and you worked on the bus routes, and I thank you. The bottom line is, you've all done a great job. Each year, for the last 4, the Board of Education has returned money to the Town Council from their budget at the end of the year, thus showing good fiscal restraint. And the children have been given a good education and stuff, meaning enough money was allocated to the schools. People may not like hearing this, but with Republican leadership and bipartisan participation, the taxpayers' money has been used with common sense. Adding more employees, both school or town, does not make for a better school or a town. It does increase the payroll, but do the children really benefit? Not always. Closing schools are done for a good reason. We didn't need all the space. It was supported by both the board and the council and the community at large. We didn't go into this alone. Our children are now in a balanced classroom and they receive more school books and technology than they have seen in years because you did a good job. Sure, you can always throw more money at anything, Doesn't make for a better student. It doesn't make for a better town. It may make for a better paid teacher or administrator or a town employee, but using the taxpayers' money with common sense, maybe not so much. A comment about people leaving Enfield may be true, but it may not be. The Center for the Real Estate and Urban Economic Studies, dated Tuesday, April 24th, cited, and it's the Connecticut Real Estate Market Update. I literally laughed when this came across my desk this morning. April 18th, Connecticut Real Estate Market Update. Connecticut housing prices declined and transactions increased in the first quarter of 2012. Holding consistent for location and housing quality, UConn estimates that a typical house declined by more than 6% over the year ending in March. Sounds kind of crappy, doesn't it? Let me get you to the good part. There were signs of stabilization or even increases in Bridgeport, New Haven, and Enfield. Enfield. We're not losing. We're pretty much staying the same. However, several metropolitan districts, areas, have lost them. Hartford, Stamford, Torrington, Waterbury. They've shown a downcrease of 10%. Not Enfield. A year ago, a condo in Connecticut was declining at 5% annually. It's 9% today. So keep in mind, people may not be moving out of Enfield any faster than they're moving in. They're kind of coming and going. I checked this with a broker, actually a couple, and I wanted to make sure it was bipartisan, so I called folks on both sides of the aisle that I know. And we have people moving in without children, and we definitely have people staying who are baby boomers whose children have moved on. And they're empty nesters. But if people are moving, and we can all give anecdotal stories, which ladies and gentlemen this evening, we have heard a few, they're moving for warmer weather. They're moving for their grandchildren. They're moving because their children have left this state for a job that they wanted to take someplace else. And they're moving because they want to be with them. Enfield is one town with very little open retail space left because we've had numerous companies coming into town and expanding right here. And you can know that just by being up on Route 5 where the Bernie's building is being filled. And Ethan Allen is barely going to stay closed because there's a church going in, and they're building the magnet school anytime soon. So bottom line is, we must be doing something right. And I thank you. We have heard it's cooperation, good management, and common goals that moves a town forward, not a division, and not politics as usual. I ask you to keep doing what you've been doing. Give me stuff, but keep my taxes as low as possible. Use common sense when it comes to spending the taxpayers' dollar. Remember, everyone works hard because they believe in the organizational goals and they truly enjoy what they're doing. Of course, I know you all do for all the hours you put in for free. And we share in the rewards. And the taxpayer deserves the respect and the thanks, and you deserve our gratitude. Thank you.
Thank you, Marianne. Next up is Bill Thompson, followed by David Wauer.
Bill Thompson, Duff Drive. Full disclosure, I am the new chairman of the Enfield Democratic Town Committee, so I thought it was rather ironic and purely coincidental that I speak after the Republican chair. About 10 years ago, I served as the chairman of the Enfield School Board. So in talking to people around town, by far their greatest concern is what's happened to the school system. Education in Enfield has endured four straight years with 0% increases. As a result, 116 positions have been eliminated, including 64 teachers. Academic and sports programs have been cut. And we've seen two elementary schools close. And as has been mentioned, it looks like Enfield is the only town in the entire state of Connecticut that has gone four consecutive years without any increase to their school budget. Now, I've also looked at the statistics regarding the per pupil comparing like towns to like towns. And it's true that Enfield is spending substantially less per pupil than the other towns. People are concerned not only about the cuts that have been made to the impact of the cuts that have been made on their children's education, they're also worried about the negative impact these cuts to education are having on their property values. Here's an analogy I've come up with. Those 0% increase.
Hey, Bill, yes. Sorry to interrupt. Can you just hold the microphone a little closer? People on this side are having a hard time hearing. Sorry to interrupt.
No problem. Those 0% increases, it's like you bought a new car and then decided you were going to save some money by not changing the oil. At the end of 4 years, you would save yourself about $500 by not doing the oil changes, but your engine would be in pretty bad shape. The Enfield Board of Education has proposed a budget increase of 1.56%. I think that's reasonable, especially in light of the 4 years of 0% increases. I support the budget even though I don't have any kids in the school system anymore. Look, I work hard for my money. And when I pay my taxes, I expect my money to be spent wisely. The failure to invest in education is not spending my taxes wisely. That failure not only impacts the kids in the school who don't have the same educational opportunities as those in other towns, it's also negatively impacting the value of my house that I paid my hard-earned money for. Therefore, I strongly urge you to fully fund the Enfield Board of Education's budget request. Thank you.
Thank you, Bill. Next up is David Wauer, followed by Lori Eli.
David Wauer, 240 Abbey Road, Enfield, Connecticut. Good evening, members of the Board of Education and Town Council. I want to, first of all, congratulate our Town Manager, Matt Koppler, and his staff for proposing effective and efficient town budgets, not only this year, but in past years. Matt, working with the current and past town councils, has done a tremendous job in identifying opportunities, ways to consolidate and make the system more efficient and more productive for our tax dollars. I also want to congratulate past Board of Education members. Specifically, I want to congratulate our past chairman, Andre Greco and Greg Stokes, for leading the strategic vision in restructuring our elementary and secondary school systems. What you're seeing today is a result of what happened over the past 4 years. I would just like to mention, because I was at Town Hall earlier this evening, and I was walking by the Skidico room, and I was listening to a property owner meet with the Property Assessment Review Committee. And what they're doing right now, and they have been doing, is looking at their assessments and the potential tax increases. We do know that overall, property assessments are down in the town of Enfield because the real estate economy has collapsed. We have over $1 billion worth of bankruptcies still out there in the system, and they can pop up anywhere, even in this town. So what I'm saying is, do we have a stable tax base? The record shows that our tax base, based on the economy, is down. And that's something that you all need to keep in consideration when you're making your decisions in the next month. What I would, in terms of mandates, and I can sympathize with Chairman Neville and members of the Board of Education. But as an elected official myself, what I can recommend is get involved with your state representatives, put recommendations on the table to change those mandates. For the past 4 or 5 years, I've been working through a state association myself to look at potential cost mandates to the town of Enfield for elections. And what you do as a member, as an elected official, go out there and continue to remind your representatives and senators in Hartford that they should be looking at the needs of the town, not other communities. But there is a way to address mandates. In terms of structure, and I will say that several years ago I served on the school board or Board of Education Audit Committee. And in that short time, citizens like myself identified a number of inefficiencies in the school system. And since that time, many of those inefficiencies have been changed, modified, or corrected. And we have to thank the councils, past and present, and implementing those changes. I still believe that given the fact that our economy is in a recession, that we have to be very careful with what we're going to be, you're going to be making decisions on in the next month. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Next up is Lori Eli, followed by Margaret Jedziniak.
Hello, my name is Lori Ely, 13 Bernardino Avenue. I hate public speaking, I'm just gonna say that right now, so I'll have a shaky voice, you're just gonna have to deal with it. I'm a new mom, 3 years old. It's been a great, great 3 years. Until I got the autism, 1 in 88. Every day, I focus on one statistic, and that's 20%. 20% of kids on the spectrum will lose their designation due to great and superior, robust special ed programs. 20%. Would you buy a lottery ticket for 20%? I'd buy that ticket. I'd spend $1 million on a ticket if I could do it. And that's the responsibility of the Enfield school system. Now, I'm shaky, I'm weepy, I'm sentimental. All those things are true. But what you also need to know is I'm the most passionate mother there is out there. And if the Enfield school system doesn't invest in these programs and improve this program and invest in it and do what's right for these kids, I'm not going to be sending my kid out of district. I'm not going to be sending them to a charter school. I'm going to fight. I've been in this town. My family's been in this town 200 years, minimum. I'm going to fight. And next time, I'm not going to go to a PPT with a nice advocate. I'll bring an attorney. And I'm going to fight for what's right. And I'm not going to stop because my kid deserves it. 20%. That's it.
Thank you, Lori. Margaret Jedziniak is up, and I need the next list.
Margaret Jedziniak, Abbey Road, Enfield. I think something is amiss, or else we're, the people in Enfield are getting a snow job, and after I read this, they won't wonder why. Because I have a budget book at home, 2001, and the teacher staff salaries were $39,000 approximately. And they had benefits of $5.5 million. And at that time, the full budget was $56 million. Oh, anybody hear that I said? It was $56 million. Now this year, we have a proposed, according to you people, a $63 million $1 million budget. How could that be in only that amount of time? And we have salaries of $43 million and benefits of $10.5 million. Benefits have gone up $5 million alone. And also, the school board is getting, or the school system is getting the benefit of $77.5 million. There were $7 million alone taken from the school system and put on the other side of the budget. That's a loan. So that comes, with all the rest, that comes to $77.5 million. And I just can't believe that we say that the budget is only $63 million that the school system is having the benefit for. Why would that be? Why is that put that way? I think the people in Enfield should really know what the whole thing is. And over the years, I have seen the money for books depleted a great deal. Pupils have complained not having a book to take home for homework, and all that was going towards the salaries instead of some of it going towards books. And because the school system is autonomous, I still believe that the economy that is so critical now that they should spend the money for what is allocated for. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Margaret. Next up is Tom Walsh. And that completes the first round list. Yeah, I think you turned it off, Tom. Put it to your...
Just spin the whole thing to you. Talk into it.
Hello?
There you go.
I came to say thank you for the past 5 years. Unlike, I guess it depends on what side of the fence you sit on, whether we have a good school system or our school system's in the toilet right now. I'm not going to tell you which way to go on this. I think we have a good council, whether you be Republican or Democrat. I've said it before, we have a really good mix of people that take care of our town here. I don't think our school system's as bad as everybody puts it out to be. But I just came up to say thank you. And the $70. Okay, yeah, some of us can afford $70 a year more. The people in this town, they can't, okay? And this $70, like I heard mentioned somebody else, it may be a lot more for business because all their stuff went up. So you got to think about that, too. Everybody's saying, well, people aren't going to move here, if we don't have a good school system. Well, we don't want business moving out either. And I hear a lot of people saying, well, we're not going to get people to move here. We can't really afford a huge influx of people with kids into town. And you got to have some kind of balance here to support this school system. Because this is only going to get worse. This $70, if you do pass this, is only a Band-Aid, a very small Band-Aid of what's to come. You have all your bargaining units that gave you something in the past that are going to come back looking for something the next time around. And there's one group that ain't going to give you anything. So it's going to get more expensive. And as I said before, you got our legislature, these fools we send to Hartford, they have to come up with another way of funding this. This is a very unfair way of funding by property value. Because you have people that pay an enormous amount of money for things, and you have other people that don't pay anything only because of they worked and bought a house. So anyways, I just came up. I wasn't going to say anything, but I sat back there and I listened to both sides of it, and most of you on this side have been here for the last at least 3 years anyways, and I think you've done a great job. I don't think you really need to be told on how to do this, because I think you all know what's in this budget and what really needs to be done. And thank you.
Thank you, Tom. That completes the sign-up. So what I'll do is, Suzanne, are there any other names on the list? So I'll just say, is there anyone from the audience, the gentleman in the red? What's that? And since you're, please remember to state your name and address for the record, because we don't have you written on a list. So.
Sure. Happy to make it on the list. My name is Nicholas D'Amato. I live at 3213 Bigelow Commons, right here in Thompsonville. I got so excited to come up and speak that I forgot the main reason in which this whole journey of mine started was because I was in the library, the central library, with my daughter, and we went to the restroom, and I noticed that there was an open reservoir soap dispensing system in there. If a dispensing system that's, you know, dispensing soap is open, then any child that's using the restroom, before they get a chance to wash their hands, they can have the opportunity, up to 21%, of contracting coli from that, which we all know comes from fecal matter. So how do you combat that? Kids are trying to do the right thing, washing their hands, and they get a risk of contaminating themselves. So that's kind of what started this whole thing. I did get a lot of information out there to some Board of Education members, some town city council members, some Chamber of Commerce members as well. It's not just to be a used car salesman and sell some products. That's pretty much what started this, because we do service a lot of the nursing homes and hospitals in the New York, New Jersey, Rhode Island, Mass, and Connecticut area. But that's kind of what spurred this for me, was seeing it there for our kids. And if we know about it, we know better, we can do better, and we can do it and save money as well. So thanks for your time.
Thank you, Nicholas. John Fox, and then Jack Sheridan.
You know, the first thing he said reminded me that I forgot to bring
John,
up.
John, name and address for the record.
Oh, yes. My name is John Fox. I live at 15 Sandpiper Road in Enfield. Anyway, he mentioned the library, and I'd be remiss if I didn't voice my support for the library. Earlier this year, we had a great meeting with some of the members of the town council and Board of Ed to advocate for the library, to come up with ideas for library expansion. And during these difficult economic times, that challenge is going to continue to get, you know, greater and greater. So I'd really like to see our budget, I don't know, I guess stay flat for the library. I'm not sure if it's in any kind of danger of having a reduced funding or anything. But for Henry, I'll just say, you know, please keep the funding where it is for the library, or increase it, because as he said at the meeting, right now he's dismantling the library and has removed 50,000 volumes from our collection. So with everything coming up with the high school expansion and the possible community center at Fermi High, I do hope that, you know, in the future, as we meet these challenges, we expand our library or relocate it to Fermi High, but that's in the future. I just want to say one other thing. Marianne Turner mentioned that Maureen Brennan, my neighbor, advocated for or had a box put on our tax bill where you could give money to the town, but that was actually, I think, for the education Excellence in Education Foundation, started a few years ago, which I think is a great idea, and I think, and I hope, and I will, you know, certainly give money to the Education Foundation. They're doing great work. They have this terrific benefit coming up for their Enfield Idol competition, and I know many of you support that. It's these things that are going to make us competitive with Summers, Simsbury. I have two people on my street who have moved to Summers in the last month. I just think that's sad, you know? I mean, they've got a great education foundation. They also have a great school system. And, you know, I just, I think this kind of investment has come due. And I really hope that, as the other gentleman pointed out, that this isn't just a Band-Aid, but we develop a long-range plan. You know, I'm on a revitalization committee. I'm going to be talking about our long-range plan. We need to develop what we have to offer as a town in our education system and in our infrastructure, as well as transportation. And we're meeting those challenges, but let's be very cognizant that, you know, not doing anything is going to cost us more in the long run than $5 a month. Okay, thank you for the second opportunity to speak.
Thank you, John. Jack Sheridan.
Jack Sheridan, 7 Buchanan Road. I'd like to remind the folks that the Enfield school system, I think, is doing a great job. Test scores have been going up steadily. I don't know where people get the idea that the school system isn't good. That's just rhetoric. They're doing a good job in spite of the fact that the increases only came through the federal grant side of it and not the town side. They did get increases, but they're doing a good job. The other thing I'd like to remind people is that even though you're talking about a 1.56% increase, you're also talking about getting 13,000 more square feet to the school addition than's required by the state guidelines. And I'd like to know why. When we already have more seats than students, why are we asking for more than we need, greater than what the state mandates are? That's going to cost us, the taxpayers, a lot more money. And the people that were saying, oh, these things will increase our value, well, those of us on fixed income, that's another problem, because not only is it the $70, but now it's an increased tax burden because the values do go up. And I subscribe to that theory, but it doesn't work for people on, so it's not just $70 is my point. Thank you very much for allowing me to speak again.
Thank you, Jack. Anyone else? Anyone else for a second time? Any comments from council or Board of Education members? I'll look down to my left and start. I think it's Joyce at the end. Joyce, anything? Donna? I can't see who's next to Donna. Jen?
No, I'll set. Thank you.
Pete? Tina? Vinny? Tim?
I just want to speak as a taxpayer, if I could.
Sure.
Okay, and it's really about the council's budget, particularly the social service budget. I think all of you know that we've been working collaboratively with Scott and the council and the school department since last fall about the issues that we've had around the suicide ideation and preventing that from happening in the community. And I noticed recently that Scott appealed to the council for an addition of funding. Was it 30,000, I think, yeah, to raise the social service budget so that we could provide some in-service and professional development to the to our staff, both town and school staff, to make them more aware of it so that we can hopefully prevent this kind of tragedy from happening. It's probably one of the most collaborative ventures we've done. We looked at it together, because it's not a school problem, it's not a town problem, it's our problem. And I appreciate Scott's work in that. It's been great, and he's been very, very supportive. And the school system has, you know, we've all worked together on this committee, meeting at least once a month for the last 6 months, I believe. And the committees came up with some very, very well-researched professional development that we think get to the kids, get to the staff, that would hopefully prevent this. So I just wanted to speak in favor of that. I thank you folks for considering it, and I just don't want those kind of things to get lost in a big budget like this. So thank you.
Great. Thank you, Tim. Pat, anything?
Yeah, I'd just like to thank the people that came out and spoke tonight and the people that are here in the audience. Like, thank Enfield High for supporting, having us here. And believe me, we take down what you say and we listen to what your conversation is. Please continue to do so throughout our budget process, you get a chance to talk to us, stop and talk to us, give us a call. It's important. That's how we make our decision. So thank you.
Thanks, Pat. Carol? Ken?
Yeah, I'd like to say a couple of things. Chairman Neville had made some comments that the scores at JFK went up. They're doing good. So the proof is there. Mr. Sheridan just spoke. Enfield scores are climbing slowly, that you can do more with less. Anybody can do more with more. Doing more with less, that's impressive. Why people are leaving Connecticut? It's no secret. It's the cost of living in Connecticut, the cost of utilities, the cost of taxes, no jobs. We do offer one of the best educations, the state of Connecticut. We have the highest mandates put against you guys. It's unbelievable. But you know what? The end result is a great product, a very intelligent student who has the ability to go anywhere, I'm going to say, on the globe and get a high-paying job that Connecticut doesn't offer anymore because these businesses can't survive in this state anymore. We all know it. Retirements, the elderly, they leave the state because they can go live down south like kings when they make $80,000 a year retired. They get a part-time job, they do great. So that could be a secret why a lot of people are leaving the state of Connecticut. It's not a local problem, it's a state problem, and we all know it's here, and it includes those unfunded mandates that they just won't let up on. I listen to everybody speak, and I take your comments very seriously. If you could tell me how funding education, $10 million, is gonna better that education and get us higher scores, I'd fund every single cent. But all I hear people say is, well, you've given them a flat budget for 4 years, it's time to give them a raise. But you don't say why. You don't say what that's gonna do to help the people. These are the answers that I'm looking for. And I really haven't, I've seen programs you wanna put back in, but the people really, they're not giving us excuses. One lady over there, she did. And I feel for her, I understand where she's coming from, and she explained why she wanted what she wanted, not because it's been a flat 4 years. So I thank everybody for coming out, and I'll take their comments under consideration. Thank you.
Thanks, Ken. Tom?
Yeah, a few things. Thanks, everyone, for coming out. Again, your comments will be well weighed. With the BOE proposed budget, and I think it's a modest increase, there are some things in here that are very needed. The social worker to be dedicated to suicides, I can't tell you how important that is that we react to a problem as fast as we can. That's something that is needed. I believe in supporting this 1.56, I think you guys have done a great job in trying to bring the taxpayer a responsible increase. It's not that much over the increase that is proposed in the town manager's budget. I think those increases are important and necessary. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. Red? Cindy?
Thank you. I do want to echo Councilman Crowell and Councilman Arnone with regards to the Board of Education budget. I do want to first thank the people for coming out, taking time to speak, all of the staff, our town manager, and the school board side. It takes a lot of dedication and hard work to put these budgets together. But I think that people need to know also that the Board of Education budget was just not born. The Board of Education budget required a lot of thought, a lot of detail, and a lot of trimming. 1.56 really is nothing to ask for. And again, it's not our job as a council to dictate to the board what needs they have, but rather the board has come to the council with very specific needs and directions, not wants, but rather very needed programs. So I definitely am going to support the Board of Education request, and I would encourage my colleagues as well. But I think it's important also to look at the town side of the budget. Our town staff is working very diligently to produce and provide for our town the best they can with very limited resources. As our town manager pointed out in his presentation, we are at the mercy of the state And unfortunately, that means that we're subject to a lot of reductions. But again, you know, we have a budget that we have to address, and I know that the 11 of us up here are going to look at all facets of both the board budget and the council, and we will do the very best job that we can for the people of Enfield. Thank you.
Thank you, Cindy. Joey?
Yeah. I want to say I believe that Enfield does have a quality education. Our scores have been rising. If everybody in the audience and the people here on the board keep saying that Enfield has a bad education, I don't care how good you go, it's going to be bad, because perception is everything. So the more we beat it up that you're going to get a bad education in Enfield, I don't care what you do, it'll never change, because the perception will always be there. So, you know, we got to be very careful when we keep talking about how bad something is when our scores are raising. Another thing on Chairman Neville, yeah, it may be $70 for the average person, but most people live in a house that are worth a little bit more than $177,000. So for the average person, the $70 tax increase is going to be a little more. But that's not what we need to worry about. What we need to worry about is all the businesses. What does just a $70 tax increase cost the top 10 taxpayers in Enfield? And these are the people that are paying all the taxes. Their burden is going to be hit even harder because their values didn't go down like the residents do. Me, I can afford a $70 tax increase, but can Mass Mutual afford a $70 tax increase on $170,000? Can the Square or all these businesses that are just hanging on by the skin of their teeth? So, and we got to keep, everyone keeps saying we need this 1.5 for the school budget. No one's saying we need money for the town to keep the town running also. So when we think 1.5 for the school, we also got to make sure we run our town forward too. So it's not just $70. It's $70 maybe to the Board of Ed, and maybe another $50, $60 to the town of Enfield, because we can't be robbing the town of Enfield right along either. So I just wanted to clear up a couple things. We can't be saying our education's bad in Enfield, because it's not. And if we keep saying it, I don't care how good we bring it, it'll always be considered substandard. And we also need to think of the town side. We can't always be thinking we only need to raise one side of the budget. And just remember, what does only $70 mean to the top 10 taxpayers? Last time I think we did that, it was tens of thousands of dollars. And these are the people that are feeding us as we work for them. Thank you.
Thank you, Joey. Tom?
I don't think it's appropriate for me to tell you how I feel right now, because I really don't know. I'm still learning, still getting information. What I am concerned about is, as I look out into this particular crowd right now, as I look at all of us, I want the people on that are concerned about this to remember, you know, come into this thought process neutral. Don't come into this thought process with preconceived notions and agendas. And I'm seeing a lot of that on both sides in a lot of the things that we do in this town. And that just leads to bad feelings, bad judgment, stubbornness, and that thing. I think we should get together, listen to the opposing view, simulate it, adjust if you feel is necessary, and give it the respect it deserves. There's been some excellent points made tonight. They're going to require a lot of thought and deliberation on our part. For the people that are at home, the only thing I'll say is go to the Board of Ed website, pull up the budget. You can see the adopted budget for this year. You can see the proposed budget. Go through it and see what you think. And let us know. We have a few weeks. We're going to be deliberating almost daily at some points here. We want to hear from you. Okay? I've already gone through it line by line, and I have what I believe I see, but I want to get some, I got some opinions tonight from some things that I quite honestly didn't know, and I got some from the other side. But it's very important that we work together to get it done. And if we put things out there in the marketplace of ideas that are half facts, that are slanted, it doesn't do anybody any good. First of all, most people can see through that. It might make you feel good, but I think that looking at both sides of these issues are really important, especially in these times, as Joe and many other people have indicated. We've got some tough things to overcome. This is one piece of it. We're doing it for our kids. We want to do the right thing for our kids. Okay? Thanks.
Thanks, Tom. Greg?
I'm all set.
Bill?
I'm all set.
Well, very good.
You?
Me?
You.
I just want to thank everyone for coming out this evening. Again, Matt Koppler for your presentation on the town, Tim Neville for your presentation on the board budget. Appreciate the public coming out, giving your input. If you've got specific questions, please come up here afterwards or approach the town manager or Tim, specific to any line items. And the council will start our deliberations early next week. And please continue to dialogue with us, email, give us phone calls. We do appreciate the feedback. Thank you, everyone, and have a good evening. Motion to adjourn by Councilman Mangini, seconded by Deputy Mayor Nelson. All those in favor? Those opposed? We are adjourned. Good evening.